Hello, happy Thursday to you. I remembered that, Thursday. Days are going so fast, I can't keep track anymore. As we continue our season of Lent, like I said last night in our Lenten service, I have a hard time carrying the total spirit of Lent forward. That is, the spirit of Lent is somber. It's a confession of our sin and an acknowledgement of where we failed God. And through that process, of course, we find redemption. We find forgiveness of sins. But it's a somber time. And yet I can't help but I just have a smile on my face, or at least it's hidden, you know, in my thoughts, because I know what's coming. When kids wait for Christmas, they can't wait to open their presents, and they see the presents under the tree. Sometimes, however, they kind of come across the gifts of mom and dad without parents knowing about it, finding it in the closet or in a drawer, or presents that they know are theirs. So they have to keep this somber attitude of, I want to see my presents. I can't see my presents. They have to keep that to fool mom and dad into thinking that they have not seen the future when the Christmas Eve or Christmas Day they open the gift. Same thing with Lent. I know what's in the present. I know what we're moving towards. And I know that that it's going to be good. And I'm going to get a gift of God, which is Jesus Christ, his forgiveness, the life he offers. And so I feel like a kid who is seeing the gift I'm going to get for Christmas. And there's a great gift. This is the gift of all gifts, the gift that God gives us in the person of Jesus Christ. In chapter 7 of Acts, we have the speeches of, the speech of Stephen. Stephen's a deacon. The apostle said we need to find 7 deacons who can take care of the needs, the material needs of the community of faith. We need to go pray and preach. And so they got the deacons, they call it. Deacons just means servant. And then one of them, Stephen, ends up being an evangelist who doesn't do his deacon job all the time, but he also does an apostolic role, kind of, which is interesting. But he gives a speech. And in his speech, he retells the story of Israel under Moses and beyond that. At one point in verse 44, it says, "Our ancestors had the tabernacle of the covenant law with them in the wilderness." That's the portable temple that they carried with them in the wilderness. It had been made as God directed Moses. On Mount Sinai, God gave Moses not just the Ten Commandments, but he gave him the blueprints for the tabernacle where he was going to dwell in some real way that had never happened before in history. "Having received the tabernacle," Moses, the blueprints on Mount Sinai, "our ancestors under Joshua brought the tabernacle in with them when they took the land of Canaan and drove out the people there. It remained in the land until the time of David." So they have this portable tabernacle, which no longer needs to be portable because they take the promised land, and then the tabernacle just sits, and priests take care of the things of the tabernacle for many years. "So it remained in the land, this tabernacle, until David, who enjoyed God's favor and asked that he might provide a dwelling place for the God of Jacob. But it was Solomon who built a house for him. However, the Most High does not live in houses made by human hands." And then verse 51, "You stiff-necked people, your hearts and ears are still uncircumcised. You are just like our ancestors. You resist the Holy Spirit." What he's really talking about is the temple. The temple had been around, for centuries there was a temple. And when Solomon finally built the temple after the tabernacle, the portable one, went through the wilderness for 40 years, Solomon builds this amazing, amazing temple, which is just glorious. And that was destroyed by Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonians. Well, later, after a generation, it was rebuilt, very modestly, but it was rebuilt. And that appears at the end of the storyline of the Old Testament. And then Herod the Great actually adds to it and makes it quite beautiful. So Herod the Great expands it. So the temple's there. The temple's a focal point. The temple is where the Israelites knew that God was in a particular way present like nowhere else on earth. He was present with them, right in the middle of the camp, because the tabernacle was in the middle of the camp with the tribes of Israel camping outside the walls that protected the tabernacle, walls of skins of animals. And so this tabernacle was with them at all times. And then when the temple was built, God's presence was seen to be there in a beautiful fashion, living with an unholy people, a holy God living with an unholy people. What Stephen's trying to say is the temple, the time of the temple is over. When Jesus died, within decades, the temple is destroyed when Rome comes to destroy a rebellion under Vespasian, first of all, then his son Titus. And they destroy, utterly destroy the temple and the walls around the city, and they destroy cities and they destroy buildings and they destroy the country, the nation of Israel completely. It's pretty interesting timing, don't you think? That the presence of God, which is seen in the temple and understood to be in the temple more fully than any place else, is destroyed at the same time that Jesus comes on the scene. What he's saying is that Jesus is the new temple. Jesus is where we discover the presence of God like no place else on earth. And Jesus, God in the flesh, came in person. And he is our temple. He is the one we worship. He is the reflection of who God is. He is God himself. So we don't need a temple. He also lives in us, Paul says to the Corinthian church, that we are the temple of the Holy Spirit, that we carry Christ in us. And doesn't have to be a distance, you know, be in a temple in the Holy of Holies with, you know, kind of protection from it, from the people. We are now holy and righteous through Jesus Christ. We're forgiven of our sins. We are now able to have the Spirit of God in us because of this purity we have because of Christ. His purity we take on as our own. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are the temple, that you are the presence of God on earth as it's never been before. And yet now through your Holy Spirit, you seek to be even more intimate with us, which you are. Through repentance and faith, you come inside us and live in our spirits or our hearts. And for that, we're grateful that you have paved the way. You have purified us to such an extent that you can now abide with us. We pray that we would enjoy that presence now and always. Amen. Let's glorify Jesus today. Ciao.